Welcome back. We now have our candidates for Stutsman County Commission. I'm Chris Shepherd, your moderator for this evening. If you have any questions for our County Commission candidates, make sure you give us a call at 252-2400. That's 252-2400. Or you can send us an email at news@kcsitv.com. That's news@kcsitv.com. We're going to start with our opening statements, and we're going to start with Mark Closey, who is on your right, my left. Mark, would you please give us your opening comments this evening?
Be happy to. For some of you that may not know me or know my background, I'm a lifelong resident of Stutsman County. I am a small business owner, and as well as serving currently as a Stutsman County Commissioner. My wife, Mona, is a nursing instructor at Jamestown College. I have a son, Andrew, who's attending graduate school at the University of Michigan State in East Lansing. He's married to Kristen, and as of yesterday, we're proud grandparents of a new baby girl, so we're pretty excited about that. And my daughter, Rachel, works at Otter Tail. I would like to thank CSI for putting on this excellent forum. It gives the people a very good opportunity to hear from the candidates and assist you in making an informed decision when you go to the ballot box to cast your vote. With that, I guess I would be very eager and happy to answer any questions that are presented this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was Mark Closey running for County Commission. Our next candidate is Nellie Deegan. Nellie.
Thank you, Chris, and thank you for our viewers and CSI for having us here today. This is a really important election as far as I'm concerned, because I am running for County Commissioner. Why? Because the people are always asking, Nellie, what's happening in our community? What's happening in our county? And if you know me or have heard about me, and I'm sure you have, so a lot of people out there, I think it's the voice of the people. It's the passion of the people. And that's what I'm about. I am the passion of, and as a citizen. When you run for any office, it's not about what you can do for us. It's what we can serve you and how we can serve you. There's a lot of concerns in this county, and there's a lot of development that's going to come our way. We have to know to make sure that the voices of the people are heard. It is so critical. From a child's life, moment they're born, until they leave this earth, there are issues. And if we don't address them, then we have to be honest and direct them. So that's why I'm running for County Commission, because I have the experience, the fortitude, the knowledge, and there's nothing that I won't attempt for the better of our community. And I have been here 17 years, and I have no place, and I am not going anywhere. So rest assured, no matter who I have to speak to reach our goals, we'll do it together, we as the citizens of this state.
Thank you so much, Nellie. Our next County Commission candidate to answer this question, to give us their opening statement, is David Schwartz. David.
Hi, I'm David Schwartz. For those of you who don't know me, I'm a retired farmer. I retired from farming in 2009 to try and relax and enjoy life, and unexpectedly became appointed to the County Commission 2 years ago when, at the passing of Doug Kaiser, to complete his two-year term. It's been a real experience. I've learned a lot, been a lot of challenges and a lot of new things that have happened in the county. I'm glad to be a part of it. The decision to run again wasn't an easy one. Being a commissioner is a very demanding and time-consuming job. There's a lot of decisions you make, the scope of them, it's so varied that it can be a challenge, but it's also a rewarding job, and it's an important one too. The reason I decided to run again was to determine the type of commissioner I've been, the job I've done, can only be determined by the people. To be reelected would be a vote of confidence that I've done the job that I set out to do. I would appreciate your vote. Thank you.
Thank you, David. We now are going to be going to our questions. The first one is, what are you doing to support the law enforcement center? What are they doing or will do to make the community a better place? And David, I'm going to start with you to answer that question. Do you want me to repeat it?
No.
Okay.
That's all right. The law enforcement center has been a controversial issue. There's been budget problems there for quite some time. I'm on the governing authority board for the LEC. We authorized a study to be done to try and determine changes that could be made to try and bring the LEC into a more profitable situation. Approximately 20% of our general fund has been committed to the LEC. A lot of the changes that are made basically are with staffing, some of the overstaffing to accommodate the courts have been changed, the food service has been changed. A lot of the employees, their schedules have been changed. I know that's not an easy thing for them, but something had to be changed there. We've been working with Tracy Trapp, the administrator, Casey Bradley, the new COO of the county, has had a lot of experience with jails. And so far, the last 2 months, we've had a positive cash flow for the first time since I've been a commissioner. I think there's more changes coming, there'll be more modifications of the study, but I think we're on the right track with it right now.
Thank you, David. Nellie, would you answer that question too?
Yes, thank you, Chris. Well, I have a lot of concerns about our law enforcement. You know, I was at that meeting that when they did the study, and one of the concerns was the input of our law enforcement. You know, when somebody goes to work and gives their life to our community, we have to respect and we have to make sure that they're secure and safe. And, you know, it's, yes, sometimes we have to talk about financing, but the law requires us to be accountable also for the employees of our county. And one of those is the law enforcement. And, you know, I've spoken to the law enforcement, and they are concerned because it does affect their children. It affects our whole community. And when they're double loaded or they're cut back and they don't have the compliancy, like, for example, when I was there, we had 29 people that no one asked questions. And they wanted to interact, and they have recommended solutions. But it's my understanding that, poof, it went out somewhere, but it didn't get back to where it had to be. So I support the law enforcement, and I will work with them, no matter what it takes, to make sure that their rights are protected as well. Because when you protect law enforcement, you're protecting the community as a whole. And let's face it, we can't do anything without our law enforcement. But we have to be in compliance. And another thing is, I think the training that they need is very critical. But how can they go to training if they don't have the manpower to back each other up? And if there is a situation in the jail, and if they don't have that backup, who's sacrificing? We're sacrificing our law enforcement and our communities. So it's critical that we address that.
Thank you, Nellie.
Thank you.
Our next person to answer that is Mark Closey. Mark.
Yeah, thank you, Chris. First and foremost, in my mind, is the economic activity in our community here and the balancing of our budgets. The law enforcement center was in a dire strait of disrepair as far as its financial condition. We needed to take some direct action to straighten it out. Under the recommendation of our new COO, we've hired a jail consultant who did interview all of the staffing people, analyze their jobs, and come up to some recommendations on how we could better staff our facility. To date, I don't know of any one person that was working full time that had their job terminated. If they left under their own free will, I guess that was their choosing. We did modify the part-time help. For instance, some of the college students that are attending school for criminal justice degrees and that type of thing, their salaries and their schedules were adjusted. We've also taken and modified, as Dave alluded to, our food service. We're going to save approximately $114,000, which we needed to do, and our food is being served and everyone's getting fed. We've increased our jail fees. We need to concur with the Federal Bureau of Corrections because they have to agree to pay the fees that we want to charge them. We just can't charge them whatever we choose. And that'll generate about $85,000 in income. With the staffing adjustments we talked about a little bit earlier here, the county's going to save about $220,000 per year. So I'm a fiscal person. I look at the bottom line. We do try to minimize all of our impacts to our employees the best we can, and I think we've done a very good job of it this time. And as far as I know, my discussions with some of the correctional people, they're a little nervous about change. Everybody is, but I don't think you'll see too much dissentment once we get this thing fully implemented. As far as the training is concerned, we've signed an agreement where we're going to be hiring a deputy administrator that's going to be qualified for training, and we're going to do as much of that in-house as possible. So with that, thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark. The next question, we're going to start with Nellie, and this is something right up your alley. With one of our local elementary schools being at over a 50% poverty level, what is Stutsman County Social Services doing to assist those children and families? What will you do about the increasing poverty level in this county?
Well, I think that's really important, and social service should be addressing. And we have, like Community Action, they have a food program that is helping our children in our district. And again, and also we need to make sure that there is funding, extended funding on preventative, and to make sure that our social services department is working hand in hand with our school system, not being an outside entity, but be a partner with our schools. Because when we do that, we're going to reach more common goals, and help. We bring all those resources together, and together we make success. And when it comes to our children, there's no excuse for not reaching these goals, none whatsoever. Because let's face it, we as adults and citizens and leaders of our community need to make sure that our children are protected first and foremost. So if someone has to go beyond the call of duty, so be it. That's what we need to do.
Thank you, Nellie. Next to answer the question is Mark Closey. Mark?
Could you repeat it, Chris?
I'd be happy
Sorry.
To. With one of our local elementary schools being at a over 50% poverty level, what is Stutsman County Social Services doing to assist the children and families? And what will you do about the increasing poverty level in this county?
As far as the school situation, I'm not up to speed maybe as I could be. We don't get that directly involved with the schools, so I'm not sure about the poverty situation there. We do have a very good social service board, and we've got an excellent director that handles and intertwines as much as possible with them on some of those issues. I would speak as far as raising the poverty level. I think our number one concern, at least mine, is the economic activity that we have in this community, and creating a job opportunity for people to better themselves through that process. And I certainly believe with all the new exciting news we've got going here, and namely the Spiritwood Energy Park, but also with the new construction on the retail side, that some of those opportunities and hopefully will open up for people where they can better themselves and their families. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Mark Closey. Now we're going to go to David Schwartz. David.
Yes. As far as the poverty level of one of the schools in the district, I guess I was not aware that it was that low. I do know that we have an excellent staff at Social Services. Also, one of the new members, Board of Directors, is involved with the schools. I know that they're somewhat limited by what they're able to do because of budgets and state regulations. I also think that with the new, all the industry coming to the area, hopefully that'll remedy some of the situation, but I'm quite confident that Social Services is doing everything they possibly can right now at that point.
Thank you, David. Our next question, we're going to start with Mark Closey again. And this is sort of a multi-part question, but it all is intertwined. So I'd like to have them have a little bit extra time on this if they need it. Here we go. It has to do with the fertilizer plant, which we've just been speaking about. With the addition of construction workers for the ethanol plant, and later with the fertilizer plant, How can the county help the city in future planning issues concerning housing? Would Stutsman County play a role in housing construction workers? And later, when the plant and fertilizer plants come online, additional workers and their families will increase the local population. What do you see as Stutsman County's role in terms of housing and infrastructure as far as the two new plants are concerned?
Okay. First, I'll start with the first part of the question, of course, and that being the temporary housing needs for the contractors that will be constructing a facility. We're a ways away yet from that happening. The company's got some hoops and hurdles to go through. They have made a commitment to come to the Spiritwood Park, but it's a process that has to be dealt with here, and when that bid letting will be, I'm not sure at this point in time. Most if not all of the political subdivisions that these facilities, and maybe a crew camp would be an example here, that would possibly be constructed or utilized would be within one of those subdivisions. Those subdivisions have their own zoning ordinances that supersede anything the county does. The county does have a blanket zoning ordinance that takes care of all the unzoned townships in Stutsman County. I think Stutsman County's role, as far as the zoning part of it, we could develop a zoning ordinance uniform throughout the county and all the cities, and have one that everybody would agree to, so anyone that wants to come in would know exactly what the entire county is thinking. As far as the locations of those, I see our role maybe going to the extent of assisting them in proper placement and that type of activity. The long-term future of housing, I realize, like everyone else does, that the houses are getting purchased here. I guess that's a good thing. And we need some new construction. We have met with on the JSDC level with some potential developers from out of state that are looking here to develop some property. Where that goes, not sure at this time, but we're very hopeful and we're actively soliciting investors to do those types of things. As far as the county putting any money into any of those ventures, I can't foresee that happening, but we are actively working on these issues at the present time. Thanks.
Thank you. That was Mark. Next to answer the question is Nellie Deegan. Nellie, do you want me to repeat that? It's pretty long.
Yeah.
Okay. With the addition of construction workers for the ethanol plant and later the CHS fertilizer plant, how can the county help the city in future planning issues concerning housing? With Stutsman County playing a role in housing, would Stutsman County play a role in housing construction workers? And later, when the ethanol plant and the fertilizer plant come online, additional workers and their families will increase the local population. What do you see as Stutsman County's role in terms of housing and infrastructure?
Well, I see the county commission doing everything that they need to do to address this. This is not something that, it's going to take unity. It's going to take our city, it's going to take our county, and yes, even Bismarck, because we're going to need to go outside that box and get resources. We need to utilize the resources that we have in our community. For example, you know, Spiritwood School will be ending, and it'll be available, hopefully, that we can utilize that facility and think about those options. You know, one of the things that I've heard, you know, we're talking about this, you know, great project that we're having, and we're very fortunate to have it. But with that same token, responsibility comes deep. And we have to make sure that our community is safe and sound, because people, it's going to affect all of us. You know, when we have camps that come into a community, and I've done my homework on this, they come into a community and they adapt faster than we can adapt. And it's going to affect our school system, it's going to affect our community, it's going to affect our seniors, it's going to affect a lot. In the end result, it is beneficial for our community. So that's why it's going to take a strong leadership of the county commissioners, all of them, not one, but all of them, to make sure that whatever we have to do to make it safe and sound in the housing and follow the ordinance and make sure that we have policies in place that when someone violates something, that we make sure it's taken care of. And also, it's going to affect our law enforcement. Our law enforcement's going to go out there, and they're going to have to make sure that our streets are protected. And so I really believe that the county commission has to play a major role in this. And if I'm elected, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to be involved in everything and anything. So that's how I feel about that. Thank you.
Thank you, Nellie. David, do you want me to repeat that, or you got it?
Would you please?
I'd be happy to. With the addition of construction workers for the ethanol plant and later the CHS fertilizer plant, how can the county help the city in future planning issues concerning housing? Would Stutsman County play a role in housing construction workers? And later, when the ethanol plant and the fertilizer plant come online, additional workers and their families will increase the local population. What do you see as Stutsman County's role in terms of housing and infrastructure then?
As far as housing for the workers, there again, some of the subdivisions have their own zoning. The commission is limited to what they can do, and also they're limited financially to what they can do. We've already had discussions with the county zoning committee regarding man camps. We've looked at adopting an ordinance. We've looked at ordinances that are in place in other counties and some of the problems they've had. Hopefully we won't have to deal with them. The projected length of time that man camps would be used in this area would be much shorter than they're being used out west. As far as infrastructure for that area, depending on where the construction would be, the county would be willing to work with the city. Like I say, financially it would be tough, but we also have to work with the townships too. It's affecting not only the city and the county, but the townships that are zoned independently. But we do have time. We've got a couple of years before any major construction is going to start, and I know it's being looked at right now. Thank you.
Thank you, David. One more question that has to do with that a little bit. With the forecasted increase in population in Stutsman County, how will you help encourage business development in Jamestown and Stutsman County, and what can the County Commission do to help that? And we're going to start with you, David.
With the increased population, hopefully job situation will expand along with the population. All this new industry coming out not only in the Spiritwood area but also in Jamestown is going to improve. There's a lot of other interest in expanding other businesses also. I think the jobs are going to be there. It's just a matter of time. The county has to continue working. JSDC is doing a good job. They've done an excellent job on bringing new industry to this area. Along with all this expansion, of course, there's always problems, but we'll have to deal with them one at a time. Hopefully that we'll be ready when the big one hits. So, thank you.
Thank you, David. Now we're going to go to Nellie. Nellie, do you want me to repeat that?
No,
okay.
That's okay. Well, I think it's important to have economic development, but with economic development, we have to have infrastructure, and that's a crucial situation that we have now, and we will continue to have if we don't address it. And again, if someone wants to develop a business or be their own entrepreneur, this is really great for our community. But we have to also find out the needs of the people and make sure that those needs are fulfilled. So if someone wants to open up a business, like anything, you have to start somewhere. Sometimes it's a smaller scale. But whatever it is that we have to do, the county commissioners have to be on top of everything. You can't just say, well, this is okay and this is how it's been done. No, we have to make a difference to make it feasible for everyone and yet accountable and serve the people well.
Okay, now we're going to start with, I'm sorry, Mark, you're right. I got it right here, you're next.
Thank you.
With the forecasted increase in population in Stutsman County, how will you help encourage business development in the Stutsman, in Jamestown and Stutsman County, and how do you see the county commission's role in that?
Well, Chris, first and foremost, that's one of my highest priorities is serving as an elected county commissioner at Stutsman County. Our financial well-being, our growth, our future depends on our economic activity. I fully support the JSDC's efforts. We've got a unified effort between the city and Stutsman County, City of Jamestown. We work with townships and smaller communities on a lesser scale. I like to do this from that type of perspective because we don't have three or four organizations run in different directions. We've got a unified effort. We pool our resources, and we're way more effective in dealing with these companies that are interested in our community. I would like to continue that effort, and the stimulus that's projected to come off of the recent development is conservatively 30% increase in our taxable valuation in the entire county, as well as upward of over 150 new employees. With them employees comes opportunities for good paying jobs here, and that's just the primary stuff. I fully expect to see a lot of retail spinoff from this and all the activity that's going to be carried out throughout the construction processes of these facilities. So my time is short here, but thank you.
Thank you, Mark. And at least I got a chance, you got a chance to answer it. If you hadn't stopped me, I wouldn't have done that.
Thank you.
Nellie, we're going to go to you next, okay? So we were just talking about the JSDC and the good job that they have been doing. That the gentlemen think they've been doing. Do you see any changes in the county's role regarding the JSDC? For example, approving projects or adjusting the county's mill levy for economic development?
Well, absolutely. I think if we have JSDC, the county has to be very proactive and make sure that when we are giving permits or whatever we're doing for economic development, that we are taking consideration the citizens of this community. Because throughout time, yes, we give tax breaks, we do this, and people say, well, how come we're not getting this, and how come we're not getting that? Well, you know what? It's really important that the county commissioners stay on top of with JSDC, work hand in hand with the city, but also to make sure that we all have accountability. When someone takes out a business, there has to be certain stipulations. And if they're taking a five-year loan or whatever it is, that is accountability for everyone. We have to make sure our T's are crossed and our dot our I's, cross our T's, whatever it takes to make sure it's in the best interest of the community. And when we do that, we will have success.
Thank you, Nellie. Mark, would you answer that question? Do you want me to repeat it?
Could you please?
Sure. Do you see any changes in the county's role regarding the JSDC? For example, approving projects or adjusting the county's mill levy for economic development?
Okay, first of all, Stutsman County is very active with the JSDC now. We have two members of the county commission that sits on the JSDC decision-making boards. I sit on the executive board as well as the full board, and Commissioner Marks sits on the full board. Any recommendations that comes off the JSDC are strictly that. They are recommendations to the City of Jamestown and the Stutsman County Board of Commissioners. Any monies that are expended through the JSDC on projects have to be approved by both city and county boards. Either one of the two boards that would veto the thing or vote it down, the project is dead. We've had that situation in the past. It doesn't happen very often. We carry on a very good line of communications. We're partners here. We want to get along. We want to have a good understanding of how the city and the county boards want to proceed on and work through that mechanism. So with that, I guess hopefully I've answered the question.
Thank you. Next to answer the question is David Schwartz. David, do you want me to repeat it or you got it?
I think I have it.
Okay.
The Stutsman County works hand in hand with the JSDC. Sometimes decisions made by the commission, brought forth by the JSDC, are very difficult because you're dealing with people, the taxpayers' money. They're very controversial. I've had a lot of calls regarding different projects, whether or not large businesses should receive these breaks that they do, but that's what brings these large companies to Jamestown and Stutsman County. It's important. Like Mark said, two of the commissioners sit on the board of the JSDC. When something is brought forth to the commission, it's already been approved by the JSDC. They've researched it, and they do a great job. I think we'll always be involved with them. and continue on.
Thank you very much. That was David Schwartz. We're going to now start our next question with Mark Closey. You ready, Mark?
Sure.
Okay. If Stutsman County receives state funding to help with roads, are there certain roads that will take priority in rebuilding or recycling?
Yeah, we do have a priority list that we've established some time back. And in our ballot measures that's been presented to the voters, Dale Marks primarily took care of that type of thing, and there was a outline given in that in those proposals. So yes, there is a road priority. It does change. Traffic generators change. Equipment, heavy equipment usage, trucks increases, and that type of thing. So they do have to be amended from time to time and reviewed. We are very limited on our resources here locally on what we can do. We're working under 12 mills. That's everything, and we got to run our highway department by equipment, and that's expensive. So our construction funds are limited, and with all the water that we've had to deal with over the past several years, it's eaten up our reserves. And instead of looking at future projects to overlay, we've had to get just the road out of the water so people can travel. So that's kind of the situation with our prioritization process, and it's an ongoing thing. Thanks.
Thank you, Mark. Next to answer the question is Nellie Deegan. Nellie?
Well, I think first of all, you have to have a short-term, long-term goal, and you have to prioritize. And we also have to make sure, again, this is part of Century Code. It is a responsibility of the county to make sure that those roads are safe for all that travel. You know, and if it takes that we have to go to legislation or we have to do whatever it takes to make a difference, then we do it. And we also have tax revenue that's coming in. We have the ag money. And my concern is, okay, when we have money coming in and it's increasing on an ongoing basis, until we actually earmark or designate funding, we have to start somewhere. We can't say, well, gee, we don't have your taxes, I'm sorry. No, we have to do whatever it takes. And if we have to change the formula to do that, then that's what we have to do. And if I'm elected, that's what I'll do. I'll get right on top of those things. And I think we have to work as partners, as all county commissioners, but remind ourselves that also we have the state that we can go and knock on doors, do whatever it takes. Thank you.
Thank you, Nellie. Next to answer the question is David Schwartz. David.
As far as prioritizing roads, we have had a plan. It has been updated from time to time. A lot of the updating had to do with the flooding situation in the last few years. The county spent out of pocket well over $3 million, or will spend that just on their share of grade raises, trying to keep the roads out of water and keep them open for people. Along with the expansion out of Spiritwood, some of the roads that were lower priority become higher priority. But then again, the funding is so limited. The federal funds that we receive yearly are being cut by $100,000 for 2013. If we try and bank those funds for any period of time to do a project, we are in jeopardy of losing them after a certain amount of time. Federal funds are drying up. We've got to look for other avenues as far as funding. We're looking for different ways of rebuilding roads at a cheaper cost. The cost of reconstruction has gone up dramatically. That's another problem. But we've been prioritizing roads as best possible.
Thank you, David. David, I want you to stay on task here. We're going to ask you the next question, too. Considering the state's huge surplus at this point in time, and that the Spiritwood projects are the largest in the state's history, do you believe the state has a responsibility to provide more funding for our county?
I would like to see the state supply more funding for our county. The Spiritwood Energy Park is serviced by county roads and township roads, not by state or federal. Basically, we were with limited budgets before. With the expansion out there, the county has to upgrade some roads and make them safe. We've got to spend money in an area we hadn't necessarily planned on. It's economic development. The state is pretty flush right now. I know there's talk of additional funding for roads in other counties other than just the oil-related ones. hopefully it'll be enough to do us a lot of good because there's a lot of need out there right now.
Okay, thank you. Nellie, could you answer the question? You want me to restate it?
No, that's okay. Thank you. Well, it's really important that we work with our legislation in our House of Representatives, because when we say, you know, we need more funding for our infrastructure and our roads out here, it is crucial. It's happening all over the state. And we are very fortunate we have these industries coming to our communities. But on the same token, it is everyone's responsibility to make sure that these roads are safe. Not only the county commissioners, but all of our senators and our representatives and our governor as well. So if I became a county commissioner, trust me, I would be talking to them about making sure that we get those. But we also have to have good faith money. We also have to designate money, because a lot of higher officials I've spoken to, they say, well, Nellie, you know, if you guys don't put some money on the table, how can we match it? So we do have to reach out and make sure we put designate that funding. We can do it. We just haven't done it yet, but we can do it.
Thank you, Nellie. Mark.
Gee,
you want me to replay? Yeah. I'd be happy to. Considering the state's huge surplus right now, and since our new projects at Spiritwood are the largest in the state's history, do you believe that the state has a responsibility to provide more funding for our county?
Yeah, I think the state's got a responsibility to an extent here. Keep in mind, they're getting wham blasted from every location in the state of North Dakota. They got the Red River Valley flood protection program that they're trying to develop. We've got Western oil field roads that are in terrible condition. It's a never-ending list of needs out there, and how they prioritize that will be a very difficult job for them. And I do want to add, however, at the last session, they did allocate close to $1 million for road money for Stutsman County to use as we so desired, I guess, and we put it in the roads or the road budget. So it was well appreciated that we received that. And I don't know how much participation they're going to be interested in listening to us this time, but I feel very confident that we'll be treated as fairly as any other county, hopefully. I can't see why we wouldn't be. I know the western counties have got some priorities here because that's where the majority of this all the oil money is coming from. We've had a very big increase in agricultural economic growth as well, but with that, I guess I fully would anticipate we'd see some assistance from the state of North Dakota.
Thank you very much, Mark. We're going to start with Nellie on this next question, and we're going to give you all a little bit more time. If anybody has any questions they want to call in, you can do that right now at 252-2400. This has to do with what you think is the top priority for the county. If you were elected county commission, what would you want the top priority to be?
Well, as far as I'm concerned, it's always the people. If we address and listen to the people, our community, we have intelligent people in our state. They're always willing to come to the table, but we have to be gracious enough to say, have a seat and give the solutions, work together. You know, we've had meetings in the past, and I've attended all these meetings, and it seems like we have the township, we have the city, we have various people in the surrounding areas, and they come in with their good intentions. But until we start applying those good intentions for our community, it's going to be difficult. We have to actually listen to their needs. And when they come in with a solution, we can't say, well, I'm sorry, we can't do it. This is not how it works. No, we can't do that. We have to actually listen and pay attention. Because when people come to you, I mean, no, I speak that as a private citizen. I think that's very important. When I go to an official, I'm saying, here I am, Nellie Deegan, private citizen. And I want you to hear what I have to say. Well, that's the voice of the people. And people have given us that right as citizens. It's not about the elected official, it's about the rights of the people. People have given their lives, so we have that freedom of choice. And when we don't respect that freedom of choice, we're also saying to every American, no matter where we live, wait, I'm here as a control factor. No, it's not about control. It's about reaching out and making sure that everyone's voices are heard. So if I'm elected and someone has a concern, well, even if they say, well, that's not a county commissioner, everything's about a county commissioner in your community. Whatever it takes, we make it happen. And I assure you, I'm far from being shy. And if I have to talk to an official for whatever level I have to go, I will do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Nellie. Next, Mark, could you answer that question too, please?
Yeah, could you read it for me, Chris, please?
Sure. What is your top priority for the county as a Stutsman County Commissioner?
Well, number one, along with the infrastructure issues, I guess, would be our economic development. I keep going back to that, but I think it's extremely important for anyone that wants to live in a community has to be able to sustain a lifestyle. And to do that, you have to have a decent paying job. And businesses are the people that hire people and pay these decent wages. And we have to make our community attractive enough to make these companies want to come here. They are very competitive. They need an advantage. They need something from us to come here. And with that, like at the Spiritwood Park, we need water. They need this. They need that. And we are fortunate enough to have some of the things that are required to retain or solicit companies to our community. I'd like to continue that effort. I think the way to do it is through our JSDC process. It's a unified effort, and we've got people that are on staff that have the time to pursue these companies. They're paid to do that, and we're starting to see some rewards from that. So I guess my number one priority would be to continue our economic development activities in a very aggressive manner and proceed forward. And also with that, possibly we could add some somehow, if we could figure out a way to increase our road revenues so that we could invest some more money in our infrastructure, would be another issue that would tie in with our economic development, of course. And I guess that's how I would proceed.
Thank you, Mark. David, would you answer the question too? What would your top priority be as a county commissioner?
Well, first of all, I'd have to agree with Nellie that the county commission is about everything, because I seem to get called about everything. But the most important thing I seem like I get called about are the roads. Infrastructure is very important. The funding for infrastructure is a top priority. We need to address the road situation somehow best as possible. This industry that's happening in Stutsman County wouldn't be there if we didn't have the infrastructure already in place for some of it. If we can't continue on improving the roads, additional industry probably wouldn't be possible either. With the short funding, it's going to be a problem. We have to prioritize the roads the best we can and try and improve them. But the main thing is the funding. We have to find different avenues of financing that, and along with that, if the industry comes in, the tax base will increase and should help some of that. But I would say the biggest priority right now is the roads.
Thank you. I'm going to have you start next, so stay on David here. You just were talking about funding. Do you think that Stutsman County voters should have another opportunity to vote on a county road tax?
I think as far as increasing mill levy on property, it's been voted down twice. I think it's pretty clear that people aren't in favor of increasing that. We did bring up the possibility of a half-cent sales tax, but I think any increase would have to be an initiated measure. I think we're 2 years away from anybody bringing up an increase in mill levy for roads. The taxes it's a touchy subject when you bring up increasing taxes for roads. People want the roads, but they don't want to increase their taxes for them. I guess we'll have to see where we end up in the future in a couple of years. I'm sure it's going to come to a vote again. It's just a matter of time. But each time it's been brought up, the history is there. It's been defeated. So I don't see that happening real soon.
Thank you. Nellie, would you... like to answer this question. Should the Stutsman County voters have another opportunity to vote on a county road tax?
I think it's up to the taxpayers. You're right. And it's my understanding, you know, when I go out door to door, and I've spoken to a lot of people, and they've called me, I get phone calls all the time. And they say, well, you know, even if we had our tax increase, we haven't seen it designated. Now, how come it hasn't happened? Well, why should I have my taxes increased? Okay. Well, you got a point. Why should we have it increase? If we don't start designating and earmarking for the issues at hand, and we just say, well, we're just going to do it this way because we always done it that way. You know, I have a real concern with that. I don't think anybody minds paying taxes as long as we make sure we allocate it properly. But again, it's up to the people. And I have a concern because we have a lot of high population of seniors. And, you know, if we don't want them to lose their homes, and we have a lot of young people that have 2-3 jobs, and we just can't go say, oh, gee, we're going to raise your tax because that's the only solution. And if we didn't have a tax increase, we still have to be accountable and we have to make things right. We can't use that as an escape to say, well, we can't do it because we don't have the taxes. And, you know, we've heard that for 20 years. We can't continue to hear it for another 20 years. So, yes, whatever it takes, again, I keep saying, we have to make a difference, and it's we, the people, that make the difference.
Thank you, Nellie. And David, would you answer that question, please?
I think you're looking at Mark next.
I'm sorry, Mark. It's not that I don't like you. I like you
Thank
a lot.
You. Thank you. Thanks, Chris. I understand the question. I've been involved with the commission long enough that I've been through every one of the ballot measures except the very first one in 1972 when they started the farm-to-market paving project with 5 mills. It's true that people in my communications, unless they can see a benefit, they're not too eager to vote for a tax increase. Visiting in the city of Jamestown, for instance, they're special assessed and different mechanisms that they have to pay for directly, and they're not eager to go out and pay for a county road that they may not ever use. So that's one of the issues. Another issue is in the rural areas where there's no blacktop county roads, the rural residents are a little reluctant to pay for a blacktop road that they're not going to enjoy the benefit out of. So there's a couple of problems there with that. I made a statement in the paper that I think that any new ideas need to come in the form of an initiated measure by the people. I think we need more involvement. I've spent tireless hours when we put these measures on, visiting communities, explaining the situations, and not very good attendance. So I think if this is at all going to be successful, it's going to have to come from a broader scope of personnel and people that are concerned enough to go through the process, the petition drive, and place it on the ballot. Thanks.
Thank you, Mark. Looks like we're about ready to do our wrap-up now, so you have closing statements. And for our closing statements, I'm going to start with David Schwartz. David, could you give us your closing statement, please, and tell us why you should be elected?
The past 2 years, I've had a lot of education. I've learned a lot of things fast. I've got to work with some very, very fine people. I appreciate the confidence that other commissioners put in me by appointing me out of a field of 19 people, some that were very qualified. I've tried to do the best job I can. I've tried to be outspoken when necessary, tried to make a few changes in things I seen that I thought needed to be changed. I also appreciate working with the people of Stutsman County, and I hope that the people realize the quality of the employees that they have. They're very dedicated, hardworking. It's been a pleasure working with them, and I would appreciate the chance to work with them in the future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. Our next wrap-up will be from Nellie Deegan. Nellie?
Well, thank you. Thank you for having us on here today, and thank you for the viewers again. But, you know, I'm running for county commissioner because, you know, a couple of years ago I ran and someone said, well, if you want to make a difference, run for county commissioner. Well, that's why I'm running again. And in the last 2 years, the concerns are still there. And until we sit down and make a difference, how can we help the people? Well, you know, I have a lot of background. I have worked with law enforcement, education, health, set up policies, lobbied as an activist for our state, even in this state. I pushed for the flood insurance because for the equality of people's rights. Why? Because it needed to be done. And people have called me and said, well, how come, you know, just even the flood insurance didn't cost us anything, but it took over a year. I had state officials said, Nellie, we've been trying to get into that county for the last 17 years. Excuse me? Why did that even happen? We have to make sure that all the benefits come to our community and our state, whatever it takes. Because if you don't venture into this, what happens is, like they say, if you don't get it, you lose it. So it's very critical that we stay on top of things to make sure that all the needs of the people are fulfilled. And I will do that. And no matter who I have to speak to, you know, and when you vote for Nellie Deegan, you're not just voting for a lady that wants to be there. You're voting for yourself to be able to have the opportunity to come to a county commissioner and be comfortable and not be afraid that if something happens, somebody's going to be upset with you. No. This is your constitutional right, and I will uphold that right. Thank you. And I appreciate your vote, and tell your relatives, your friends, and everyone over 18, it's okay to vote for Nellie Deegan. Thank you.
Thank you, Nellie. Mark, you're the last to do a wrap-up for us.
Thanks, Chris. Again, I would like to thank you for putting on this form, and hopefully people got some good ideas on where the candidates stand. I've been a county commissioner for 7 terms. I've enjoyed it. It's really been some time demands put on me, but I managed to work through it. As a commissioner, you sit on various boards and committees, and they do meet, and as of late, the Development Corporation has been meeting on a regular basis. It seems like daily almost with the activities we got going, but I'm a dedicated individual to Stutsman County. My heart is here. I've lived here all my life. I have a business here. I've enjoyed it again, being actively involved with the process. I think I'm a fair person. I think I do my homework. I like to think that I get as much information as I can before I make a decision and do the best job that I can for Stutsman County. And with that, I guess I would ask for your consideration in the ballot box whenever you choose to vote, because early voting is going on now, and the 6th is the last day. So, thanks.
Thank you very much. And we'd like to thank all of you for watching this evening and calling in your questions and emailing them to us. We will be replaying this as well as our other programs now through election, and election night we will be doing city matters and election returns. I wanted to let you all know that the schedule is available. I could read it to you, but here it is, and you don't want me reading this tonight. So thank you for watching, and for cable services and KCSI-TV, I want to thank you. Good night.
The KCSI TV 10 studios, located in the CSI Technology Center at Historic Franklin School, this has been Meet Your Candidates. Watch replays of Meet Your Candidates, the award-winning voter information TV series, on CSI TV 10 replay channel. Join the CSI News Now team, election night, Tuesday, November 6th, for City Matters Live at 7 p.m. and local election returns at 8. Tuesday, November 6th, City Matters and election returns. CSI TV 10, the replay channel, your election source.